Thank you. Welcome to worship. The youth groups meet after late church today. We will be having sub sandwiches, chips, and drinks for lunch, and then going out to do a service project. Lenten services continue this Wednesday until March 20. This week, our dinner is by Diana and me, sloppy joes, green peas, and corn. Please sign up by the kitchen and let us know if you plan to come for dinner. Thank you to the Barrel Choir for enhancing our worship today with your music. We are grateful for Dr. Chris Brown, who is our director. Easter is March 31. We have a sign-up sheet by the kitchen for those who would like to donate Easter lilies to beautify our altar on Easter morning. The cost is $10 per lily. And for you guys online, we had a little glitch, but I think we're up and running. So we are ready for the bells.
Morning.
Sir.
Warmed up, I want you all to stand, and I want you to turn around, and I want you to say hi to your neighbor, and just get to know people here a minute. We're going to take a minute to do this. Yeah, remain standing because we're going to begin the service this way. I thought, you know, we're not really mixing real well and meeting new people, and I thought this is a good way to start to do that, right? And so we start out with that. That said, as we've greeted our neighbor, let's make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. For zeal, your house has consumed me, and the reproach of those who reproach you have fallen on me. Deliver me from sinking in the mire. Let me be delivered from my enemies and from the deep waters. Let not the flood sweep over me, or the deep swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me. Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. For zeal for your house has consumed me, and the reproach of those who reproach you have fallen on me. We pray. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first lesson is written in the book of Exodus, chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to the thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. The epistle lesson is written in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 18. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weaknesses of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The gospel according to St. John, chapter 2. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, "Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade." The disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." So the Jews said to him, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said to him, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them, because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about a man, for he himself knew what was in a man. That's it. This is the word of the Lord. We confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated.
Just to prep you for this song a little bit, you heard the epistle lesson. It talked about the foolishness, right? Things that seem foolish. And think of this one. Peter, get out of the boat. Seems foolish, right?
Thank you. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never failed and you won't start now.
Here we go, ready?
I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves.
When mountains rise, my soul will
rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander,
and
my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Thank you, Craig, Mary, and Whitney. Get these back here. At this time, our children will come forward. You want to come up today because I got presents here. Coming up, Dave, here. Yeah, move those books. Let's move these. Thanks. There we go. All right. This is the season of Lent. Can you read that word, L-E-N-T? Can you read that? What color are those letters? Are those green letters? What color are they? Are those purple? Yeah, that says Lent, L-E-N-T. That's the season we're in, because that is the season in the church year when we see Jesus go to the cross. What did he do on the cross? He died on the cross to save us from our sins, right? What are some of our sins as children? How about not cleaning our rooms? Is that a sin? Yeah. How about not listening to our mom and dad? Is that a sin? How about hitting our brothers and sisters or friends? Is that a sin? Yeah. We sin, don't we? We all sin, don't we? And that's why Jesus had to go to the cross. And look, there's two nails there, because where did they put those nails? On his hands, right? And they put the nails in his feet. Now, on the back side of this are some Lenten symbols, right? See that man right here? It's actually on the sticker, right? Take a look at the sticker. What's on his forehead? A cross. Were you here at the service when we put ashes on the foreheads? Huh? Right? And I said, to dust you are, remember, to dust you are and to dust you will return. Right? So yeah, we get ashes. What do the folded hands mean? That's praying. It's important to pray to Jesus, isn't it? Right? Every day we should be praying to Jesus. And there's the cross, right? The cross sticker. And why is there a red cloth over it? Because, yeah, he rose, didn't he? He's not there on the cross anymore. He rose from the dead. And there's Jesus on a
donkey.
Yeah, on a donkey. He's coming into Jerusalem to die. And the children are out there waving palm branches going, what? Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Right? And there's a fish. I don't know what the fish stands for. A meal of fish. During Lent, sometimes we eat fish on Fridays, right? And there's the chicken, right, that crowed when Peter denied Jesus. And what's that right there? Is that a?
The nail.
That's a crown, isn't it? A crown of thorns. Who wore a crown of thorns? Did that hurt? Those sharp things sticking in his head? Yeah, that hurt him a lot. And of course, there's where we remember to give money for Jesus. And they're washing. I got to look and see what that is. We have foot washing. Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Did you remember that?
Yes.
That's a nasty thing to do, isn't it? To wash somebody's feet. And Jesus was a rabbi. He wasn't supposed to wash people's feet according to the Jewish law, but he did anyway because he wanted to love his disciples. And then that's the bread and the wine that was in communion, which is like we have in church when you come up for a blessing. And that right there is the, what, Calvary, where Jesus died on the cross for our sins. So these are stickers. And guess where they go? On here. And you can tell where the stickers go because there's a picture, right? So there's stickers. And on the back, you can have your mom or your dad read what each sticker is about, okay? So I have one of these for you all to take home today in one of these envelopes here. So would you like stickers?
Yeah.
All right. Let me pull them out. Jace, there you go. There you go, Gabe.
Can I go now?
Yeah, you can go now. As soon as I give you one, you can go. Here you go, girls. Well, if I can get a hold of it. There you go, Charlie. There you go, sweetie. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. This is out in the Sinai wilderness. This is where the Israelites went. God, when it was time, Moses, if you want to put him date-wise, is about the 15th century B.C. They were under slavery in Egypt for between 400 and 450 years, sometime in there. And God finally said through Moses, it's time to go to the promised land. And remember how they were miraculously delivered from Pharaoh and his army by God parting the waters of the Red Sea. They went across on dry ground, and when the Egyptians followed them, God collapsed the water on them, and they perished. From there, he took them out into this desert. Imagine a million people, their animals, their goods, everything that they had, being carted out through this dry, barren land. One of the biggest struggles would be to find water. And of course, in so many ways, God miraculously gave them water until they got to the foot of the mountain, Mount Sinai, right here. They think this is the mountain where they went, although we don't know for sure, but this is where they think. And the monastery wasn't there in Moses' time, but it is now. And this is what it looks like, Mount Sinai. Picture the cloud on the mountain. Picture that mountain quaking. Picture the thunder and the lightning as God came down and settled on that mountain in all of his might and in all of his glory. It must have been an awesome thing because the people were afraid, They were commanded not to go up to the mountain, not even to touch it. And yet God called Moses up onto the mountain, and he met God there. Not quite face to face. Moses said, God, I'd like to see your face. And God said, if you behold my face, you will surely die. So God put Moses in a cleft of the rock, and he passed by, and Moses saw God's backside in all of his glory, and he came down glowing for 40 days. All happened up on that mountain. But the most significant thing that really went on up there is God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments were written on one stone. That was God's copy. Ten Commandments were written on the other stone. That was the copy for the people. And literally up on the mountain, God, the bridegroom, marries his people, Israel. It's a marriage. Meanwhile, down below, since Moses took so long coming down, they had Aaron make a golden calf, and there they committed terrible misdeeds, and as a result, 3,000 of them were killed. And the counterpart to that is at Pentecost, 3,000 were saved. That's the counterpart to that particular passage. Why did God give his people the Ten Commandments, the law? We got to go all the way back to Eden to learn that. Remember when Adam and Eve were created? On the sixth day, God looked at all of creation and he says, it is very good. And on the seventh day, God rested. His way of saying, Adam and Eve, enjoy what I've done. Adam and Eve did not know sin. They had no idea what it was because the law of God was written perfectly in their hearts. It was like part of their DNA. They only could do what was right. Two trees were in that garden, if you remember right. The tree of knowledge, when if you ate that fruit, it had life restorative properties. You could continue eating that fruit and live forever. Kind of like a Ponce de Leon type thing, right? The tree of life, and God gave them access to it. In Revelation, incidentally, that tree is on both sides of the river, because in heaven there's even easier access to it. But the tree that got them in trouble was the one single tree that God told them not to eat of it, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Imagine, as you go home today, count the number of trees you pass by. And that's just from here to wherever you live. Imagine all the trees in the world, and God said, you can have them all, Adam and Eve, enjoy them. But this one tree, right here at this one tree, I don't want you to eat the fruit, lest you shall die. And what God's saying is, enjoy my creation. Participate in taking care of it with me. But at this point, at this tree, I'm still God, and you're still the creature. Worship me, honor me, don't eat the fruit of it. And they didn't. Till the devil came along in the form of a snake and tempted them. God knows that if you eat of this, you will be like him, knowing good and evil. Well, it looked good to Eve, and it was pleasing to the eye. And so Eve took some, and she ate it, and she gave some to her husband, and he ate it too, and then their eyes were opened. This perfect law of God that was written in their hearts had now been literally destroyed. It was no longer perfect, imperfect. And that's how it was. As generation after generation came along, the law becomes weaker and weaker. It becomes less understood. It falls into the darkness of sin. And without any word from God, generations later, who knew anymore what was right and what was wrong? You think it doesn't work that way? When I was a child, I went to school during the week, and on Saturday we played in our little town, and on Sunday most of the people went to one of the five or six churches in our community. If we went to school on Monday, we'd be talking about what happened at church, and you know, the few of them who didn't worship, you know, the unbelieving type, they were largely in the minority, and well, they just didn't say much about us going to church because we would have set them straight. Well, look at us now. That was what? 60 years later, and look what's going on in our culture as it's largely forgotten about God. You realize, you know the Ten Commandments, right? What's going on in our world? Right is wrong, wrong is right. Turn on the news, and you're going to hear nothing but lies. You know, propaganda, what they in charge want us to hear, interpreted how they want us to know it. You have to dig deeper for the truth. And they just blatantly lie and think nothing about it. It's okay. Going to church. Yeah, I'm too tired today. I think I'll stay home. Yeah, it's okay. God, you know, I know who God is. Let's just leave it that way. And the sixth commandment, do not commit adultery. That's all but forgotten, especially in the younger generations. It's sad. What happened to the law of God? Cut off from God's word, it grows dim, it grows weak, it becomes less clear. And our sinful human nature just kind of takes over and says, well, you know, the Ten Commandments are really, well, let's just call them 10 suggestions and go on. Although, you know, the gross laws, they're still kind of there in our hearts. Everybody knows, whether you're Christian or not, that it's probably not a good idea to kill somebody. But steal, if I can get away with it. Oh, and I can talk about my neighbor, especially in social media, because they're not there. I can say whatever I want. Do you realize people in our world are creating their own alternate realities? Remember back in the garden, God said he made them male and female. Male and female, he created them. I think the Bible points out two sexes, and as somebody said this morning in this sermon, how many are there now? 63 and growing? And people in the world who don't know the law of God want us to play along with their delusions. But that's what happens when you're not attached to God and his word. That's what happens when the Ten Commandments become meaningless, or they become so dull that we don't even know what's right and wrong anymore. And that's exactly where the children of Israel were when they approached Mount Sinai, right there on the mountain. Let me see if I got another picture. Yeah, right there. The law of God was dim. And God, in his great love for his people, said, I need to restore this so that they know what's right and they know what's good. And so God calls Moses up the mountain, like I said, God writes this on these tablets. So once again, the children of Israel, God's people, can read the law, to read the Old Testament lesson, and know how God wants them to live. God is restoring here what was lost in Eden for time and for eternity. So yeah, I can look at what's going on in the world, and I can read the Ten Commandments. You know, how do they go? Number one, you shall have no other gods before you. Number two, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Number three, worship. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Number four, don't talk back to your parents. No, honor your father and mother that it may be well with them, that thou mayest live long on the earth. The fifth commandment, do not kill. The sixth commandment, do not commit adultery. The seventh commandment, do not steal. Number eight, do not bear false witness. And number nine and ten, do not covet your neighbor's wife, his home, his goods, anything that is your neighbor's. Be satisfied with what God gives you. That's the prelude to the Torah, the Ten Commandments. You know, it can be kind of harsh, right? It's like, okay, God, I can't do all these things. Are you raining down on my parade? No. I mean, the law has functions, doesn't it? Three, number one, it acts as a curb. If I get mad at you, I just can't bump you off because I'd probably go to jail and end up in the electric chair, at least in the state of Alabama. So it stops me from doing things that I don't want to do. I might be in a hurry and speeding, but if I see a policeman coming, I slow down and go, like I'm not doing anything wrong. Then he goes by and I go, The law acts as a curb. It also acts as a mirror. I can stand in the mirror, hold up the Ten Commandments, and I can take a look at myself and go, oops, 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 10 times, right? Because I don't measure up. And I know at this point that I need something outside of me to save me from what I am as a sinner. because it's not coming from in here. That's why Jesus came, didn't he? He came to keep the law perfectly, and he did. He didn't sin once, which made him the perfect righteous sacrifice to go to the cross for our sins. He shed his blood, paid the price of our sinfulness so that we could be bought back. And that brings us to the third use of the law, right? Where it describes to us as Christians how God wants us to live. Because, you know, if we live the way God wants us to live, life is going to go better. I'm not saying easier. It's a broken world. Life will go better. You won't face the nasty consequences that come when we find ourselves in some kind of sin. I know two girls in Alberta who thought it would be cool one night to sneak out of the house in the middle of the night and go someplace fun. I don't know where they went. I know by the time 7 o'clock rolled around, it was time to go to school. They had been in an accident, and one of them was dead. It was just a little sin, sneaking out at night. As a result of that, she never grew up. She never went to college. She never got married. She never had children. She'll never be a grandmother, all because of one little mistake. And she probably thought her parents were unfair by insisting on the rules of the house. She lost her life over it. Those are sometimes the consequences that come as a result of our sinfulness. Sometimes the littlest sin brings the greatest consequence. Abraham's proof of that. He took Hagar as his wife. Sarah bid him to do it. He did it. And now we have two nations in the world ever since that are warring against each other. It's the turmoil in the Middle East. Abraham's two sons. One little sin. That's it. We often think we sin in a vacuum, but we don't. Our sins affect the people around us. It's why we need our Savior. It's why we need the law. Because when we look at it and pray to God, God, forgive my sins, but help me with your power to live according to your word for my joy and my happiness and for the joy and happiness of all those around me. And the catch-all is when we fail, and we do fail. Our loving Savior comes with his bruised hands and feet. He picks us up out of the ash heap and he says, my son, my daughter, I forgive you. And he does that every time we sin, every time we go to him for help, every time we go to him for mercy, he forgives our sins. And he does it sometimes even when we don't ask because we believe in him. That's our Savior. That's our God. And his law, don't fight it. It's how he wants us to live. It's how he designed us as human beings. This law should be part of our DNA. It should be built in. But because it's grown dim, God continues to build it in through his mighty word. I'm going to close with a story. Those of you who didn't know how this building used to be, the doors were there coming in. There was still a door here. The bathrooms were right over here. My office was right over there where the closet is. And the church office was right here where I'm standing. I was literally in this place sitting at the conference table at a Sunday school meeting. We were talking about the curriculum and, you know, Bible stories. And we were just going on through our meeting. Kitty corner across the street, that White House in the corner, lived a kid named Charlie. He's a cute kid. He was on my soccer team, loved to play soccer, so I knew him pretty well. And Charlie was pretty proud one day because his dog had puppies. And those were cute little puppies, too. Their yard is fenced, and those puppies were in the yard, and they were running around the yard just free as can be. They could do what they want, anything they could in the yard, and they were happy puppies. One morning, I was driving to church, and I noticed one of the puppies was out. I told Charlie, hey, Charlie, your puppy's out. He goes, puts the puppy back in the yard. The next day, the dog was out again. It was digging out from under the fence. It did not like the fence. And that puppy was something else because his tail was higher than the dog's inside. His head was higher. He was prouder than all of those dogs. He was outside. He was in the world. He was living free. He did not have the fence to hold him back. He could go where he wanted, do what he wanted, and that was one happy puppy. Sitting here talking to the Sunday school ladies, we heard this terrible screech of a car. Screech! And then the worst howling I have ever heard. For 30 seconds, that puppy screamed while it died. It broke my heart. You see, the fence is the law of God. When we live inside the fence, God protects us, God keeps us safe. If we dig out for whatever reason, we risk terrible things. The law is our friend, not our enemy. God gave it to us so that we could be like him. God strengthens us in the gospel. He changes our hearts and our minds and puts inside of us a desire to live the way that God wants us to live. It's what separates us from those who don't know the Lord. It's what we want them to see in us that would make our faith more appealing to them when we act out who we are under God's grace and under God's blessing. God did this out of love. You remember how the commandments begin? Not just the commandments. Moses, this is what I don't want you to do. Right? No, I am the Lord your God. That's who he is. Who did something for you, brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of bondage. This is who I am. This is what I've done for you. Now, therefore, this is how I want you to live. I am the Lord your God, who delivered you from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. Therefore, this is how I want you to live. May God give you power through his word to live the way he wants you to live. May the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the true faith through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we pray for my son Mike Ringers for continued healing with his leg, the Tucker children for God's protection, for both Leo and Wanda Ramos who are having health issues, and especially Leo right now, he's the sicker of the two. For Madeline Pettit, that God's will be done. She may be able to deliver a healthy baby. She has cancer and is pregnant, brain, breast, lymph nodes, and lung. For Mary Oldenburg's cousin David, who was hit by a car while he was on his bike and is in a trauma unit for head and other injuries. And for Mary's uncle, who is in the hospital. We rise for prayer. O Lord, you are a jealous God. Save the third and fourth generations that will come after us from your punishment. Fill us with your son's zeal for your house, that we may cast every idol from our heart and be devoted to you and your commandments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, your son's cross and crucifixion is folly to the world, but it is the source of repentance and forgiveness for all his elect. Preserve the preaching of the cross in our midst, that from this life-giving tree we would continually receive your faith-preserving gifts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, bless and preserve all Christian households, that husbands and wives would live in love and service to each other, that fathers and mothers would be diligent in bringing up their children in your fear, and that children would honor their parents and be well-equipped for service to their neighbors in this life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord of the perfect law, you have called us to honor our parents and all authorities, that it may go well with us in our land. Bless our president and all who govern us. Make them wise in your ways, that your justice may be upheld among us. Help us to serve and obey them in accordance with your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord our God, your steadfast love in Christ is good. Turn in your abundant mercy toward all who suffer in our midst, particularly Mike Ringers, the Tucker children, Leo and Wanda Ramos, Mary Oldenburg's cousin, Mary's uncle, and Maydeen Pettit. Do not let the flood sweep over them, nor the pit close its mouth on them. Deliver them and grant them healing, comfort, and peace according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. O Lord, our rock and redeemer, though we cannot even discern all our errors, declare us innocent in Christ of all hidden faults, and by your Holy Spirit, keep us back from presumptuous sin. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, you bless this day and make it holy with your word and the gifts of your altar. Grant that we may come before your presence to eat your Son's body and blood, not boasting of ourselves, but of Christ alone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, our rock and redeemer, 3 days after the temple of your Son's body was destroyed by wicked men, he raised it up again. Grant that on the last day, we and all the saints who now rest in your presence may share in the glory of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Take and eat the true body of Jesus, given into
Lord, you are the maker of my heart, framer and reshaper of my soul, master and creator, healer and sustainer. I will put my trust in you alone. Teach me to be faithful to confess. And in this way my spirit will be blessed. Though my sins are daily, you have loved me greatly, removing them as far as east from west. Let me be open, let me be humble, let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. Let me be broken whenever I stumble, let me remember the great mercy of my God. Give me the full measure of your grace, as it is reflected in the word. Faith and reassurance, your mercy and endurance, I'll carry these to those who haven't heard. Let me be open, let me be humble, let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. Let me be broken whenever I stumble, let me remember the great mercy of my God. All I have needed is laid at your table. All my achievements I lay at your feet. Alive in your spirit, I'm willing and able. You make my joy complete. Let me be open. Let me be humble. Let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. Let me be broken whenever I stumble. Let me remember the great mercy of my God. Yeah, let me be open. Let me be humble. Let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. Let me be broken whenever I stumble. Let me remember the great mercy of my God. All I have needed is laid at your table, and all my achievements I lay at your feet. Alive in your spirit, I'm willing and able. You make my joy complete. Let me be open. Let me be humble. Let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. Let me be broken whenever I stumble. Let me remember the great mercy of my God.
Rise. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen. We pray. We give thanks to Almighty God that you've refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Our last song this morning, Trust in You.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary and I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. truth is you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Yeah, I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Yeah, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Thank you.